Good morning, guys. My name is Scott Wolfenshire. I'm really excited to worship with you. Open in prayer, okay? Dear God, thank you so much for this morning and the chance that we get to get here and just worship you and open up our hearts, God. I pray that you lead us through worship this morning and that we can just fix our eyes on you. In Jesus' name, amen. Alright, you guys stand. We're going to start singing.
Jesus.
Open up my eyes in wonder and show me.
be doing here today, but are we doing those things in our life outside of this place?
Yes.
Lord, we need you this time.
Yeah.
There are people that are hurting in what's going on in the world, what's going on in our country, what's going on in our church, what's going on in our homes.
Yes.
Things that we don't even know about. But Lord, we need you during this time.
Yeah.
We need that foundation, Lord. We need to rely upon that foundation. We need to believe it. We need to trust it, have faith in that foundation.
Yeah.
The foundation is you, Jesus.
Yes.
Jesus, you came to this world. You died for our sins and for our lives and for our eternal salvation.
Amen, Lord.
You gave us hope. And you're the only one that can do that, Lord. You're the only one that can save. Lord, we're here today. We're here to serve you, to worship you, to sing about you, to pray to you.
Amen.
Open our hearts, open our ears and our eyes, that we may be attentive to what you have for us today. So, Lord, I believe you have something for each and every one of us today. Lord, be with us today. Your spirit is welcome here. Lord, be with each of us today. And for Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
You may be seated. Welcome, everybody that's here. Welcome those of you that are online. We are honored that you are here. And just pleased that you're here. So thank you for coming today. If you look at your bulletin, a few announcements before Bobby comes up here in a little bit. A couple of announcements. There's a lot going on. If you look at your bulletin, we have the 5th Sunday night of worship. There's a sign-up sheet outside for that. And that will be just a time of singing. Maybe you've got a solo. I think Brother Lyle may have a solo he wants to share.
Amen.
He was getting on me in Sunday school.
I can make a joyful noise, I promise.
Amen. Love you, brother. Did you have something to add to that?
I was going
to
say, if you want to share a testimony, it doesn't have to be musically related. Something the Lord did. This is all about worship. So
yeah. Testimony, or if you have some scripture you'd like to read or anything in that realm, please feel free to do that. Let's see. The students are going to tune in Helen on Saturday, August 29th at 9 a.m., so be aware of that. Awana will be starting September 9th. And if you have any questions about that, you can see Brother Bobby. But you can read through there the needs for that. We have a church council meeting today at 4:45 in the lower part of the building out there. So if you're in charge of a particular part of the church, please be aware that that is happening at 4:45. We have a fall festival that we are starting to lay the foundation for that. And you'll hear more about that, but we're going through some ideas. Anyone that has ideas about that, please feel free to share those with individuals or with the church office for now. And we will put more together with that as far as food and what we want to do. Do we want to go inside? Do we want to go outside? There's a lot involved in that, so the discussions have started. But there's a lot to figure out here, so please be in prayer about that as well. Let's see. The stewardship area, you'll see the numbers there. And let's give God a round of applause for that. Because we are that's a God thing. That's a true God thing. So I think that's about it. As Bob last asked after, is that done? All right, looks like it is. So we're going to stand and greet each other, and Bobby will come up and share a message with the kids. So go ahead and stand up, greet each other. Do it in a COVID-19 friendly way. So thank you.
You're up there playing the guitar, so am I supposed to count you as a musician and a speaker?
Ralph or Weldon. Then you also have Barb and Terry Weldon. Maddie Burke, Sherry Wills, Miss Anna, like I said, Ralph and Floyd. And if I miss any others, I apologize. If you join in on prayer meeting always. Miss Vicky, I know, has attended prayer meetings. Miss Cindy's been to one or two prayer meetings in her past, but I don't know. And it's several others. But boys and girls, what they do in there is they pray. They pray for us. And what I wanted to encourage you with that is to use it as an example for you to pray for others. I'm always reminded of this great banner we have in the back of our church. It says, Jesus saved your soul. It's an acrostic for joy. And that's really the priority you can think about in prayer. I've been doing 5 minute prayer, but you can think about joy too, because you want to praise Jesus first. And then you want to pray for others, and then you have to do spend time to pray for yourself. That's okay. God wants that, desires that. I thought that was a great example of encouragement to pray for others. And something you can do, so this is something I've done. Pastor Brown has just done an awesome thing, putting this list together. If you haven't seen one, you're probably going back here on the stands, and I know there's some out in the foyer. But he's put together for us a guide for them to follow. And there's a lot of things in there. It's about praying for yourself, but there's a lot of others that you can pray for. And then if you like me, you can make notes for what I did. A lot of days, I don't know if I can pray for all these things at one time. Before, 40 things, right? But what I did is I broke it down by day. I kind of divided it up 5 or 6 things a day to be able to pray through 7 days and try to get all those things on there. But I just encourage you, kids, that if you don't have one of these, maybe grab one, maybe here today. You're like, I don't know what I do. And you're like, I don't know how to pray. Well, we can talk more about how to pray. If you listen to Pastor Dunn, he's teaching us about prayer and a lot of different things. There's a great example. You can go to the Bible. Read the 17th chapter of John. Jesus teaches us about interceding for others. The master teacher, the best teacher that we can ever have.
Amen.
But I just want to encourage you to pray for others, boys and girls. And kids, young at heart, we pray for each other, we're lifting each other up, because that's what's going to get us through hard times, the good times, difficulties we walk through in life. You know, sometimes we have difficulty with school, boys and girls, what we're learning, what we're studying, maybe it's a specific subject you have. We all go through difficulties, and we all need prayer in the midst of life, no matter if we're going through pandemics or not. And distance learning and on-site learning and all of these things that we're dealing with now, that's not easy. But Jesus wants to walk with you in the midst of it. I think one of the great examples I've seen and heard before, and I may get it wrong, so I'll try my best here. They talked about when Shadrach and Meshach and Abednego were in the fire. God didn't take them out of there, but he was in the fire with them. And that's how it is with Jesus. Sometimes we don't come out of the difficulty we're dealing with. But he wants to walk with us in the midst of us and carry us through it and get us through the difficulty. And so that's what he's doing right now. But really, when you get that comfort, you get that peace, is when you have Jesus in your life. But when you spend time communicating with him, talking to him, that's what prayer is. It's just spending time talking to God, communicating with him. We show really how much we value that relationship by how much we talk to him, how much time we spend with him. That can be convicting for me. So we want to pray every day, and we want to pray for others specifically this week. And that's right. Father in heaven, Lord, thank you so much, Lord, that we have the opportunity to pray you. And Jesus, you made a way for us to go directly to you. We give you all praise and glory this morning, Jesus. Thank you for the opportunity we have to pray for others. We have the opportunity to pray for our family, our friends, and our teachers, and our administrators in school. Lord, that we can lift up church friends and church family, youth group friends, children's ministry, a lot of friends. We can lift up our pastor. We can lift up others. We can pray for others, and what a great thing we can do. And we can give people. I thank you, Lord, for our prayer warriors being on Wednesday nights to pray for this church and pray for others in our community. Thankful for their steadfastness and their faithfulness to pray for. Help us as a praying for other people this week, Lord. We thank you for all this, and we give you all the praise. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
All right. The priest will come back up. Phil led to read some scripture before this song, if that's okay. Hopefully. So this next song is about, it's called Death is Arrested. It's about Jesus rising on that Sunday morning, Easter Sunday. And I know it's not Easter Sunday, but you don't need Easter Sunday to celebrate Jesus resurrecting, right?
Amen.
Amen. So I'm going to read this. This is just from the morning that he rose in Matthew 28, okay? It says, after the Sabbath at dawn on the first day of the week, Mary Magdalene and the other Mary went to look at the tomb. There was a violent earthquake, for an angel of the Lord came down from heaven and going to the tomb, rolled back the stone, and sat on it. His appearance was like lightning, and his clothes were white as snow. The guards were so afraid of him that they shook and became like dead men. The angel said to the woman, do not be afraid, for I know that you're looking for Jesus who was crucified. He is not here. He is risen, just as he said, come see the place where he lay. They go quickly and tell his disciples, he is risen from the dead, and he is going ahead of you in Galilee. There you'll see him. Now I told you. Stop there, but if Jesus did not rise from the dead, we wouldn't be here today. He's the ultimate reason, right? For faith, and we're going to celebrate that. So we're going to sing the song called Death is Arrested. You guys can stand back up.
Thank you.
We accidentally left a number the same one week, so it didn't change. we caught that together. So the numbers that you see in the bulletin today are correct, and we can't praise the Lord for that. That we are above budget. So praise the Lord for that. And then church council meeting this afternoon at 4:45 as well. So so some prayer preventions here. And what I want to do is I want to first clarify real quick with you, what am I talking about? I'm not talking about if you have, things that keep you from praying. For example, like if you're just apathetic, you don't want to pray. Or if, there's distractions, like our phone. I don't have mine. The phone's down there, but, I've been there. We're trying to have some quiet time with the Lord. We're reading our Bible. We're praying. And we got our phone next to us, and you know what that thing does? It just dings and dings, and it tries to fight for our attention. So this morning, when I'm talking about prayer preventions, these are things that are not things that keep us from praying, but these are things that if we are praying as praying people, if we're going to the Lord and we're spending some time in prayer, these are some things that will keep us from our prayers being maybe answered, or maybe being as effective as they could be. And so I just want to give you three. There's more than these three, but I think these three things are probably one of the biggest prayer preventers that you and I as believers can face. And so as we look at these today, let's self-examine. Let's not point to our spouse and say, yeah, they need to work on that. Let's look at ourselves first and say, yeah, I need to work on this. How am I doing in this area? In these three different areas. So let's get to it. Let's, number one in your outline is the five-letter word, pride. Let's look at the scripture here in Luke 18, and let's look at verses 9 through 14. To some who are confident in their own righteousness and look down on everybody else, Jesus told this parable. Two men went up to the temple to pray, one Pharisee and the other a tax collector. The Pharisee stood up and prayed about himself. God, I thank you that I'm not like other men, robbers, evildoers, adulterers, or even like this tax collector. I fast twice a week and give a tenth of all I get. But the tax collector stood at a distance. He would not even look up to heaven, but he beat his breast and said, God, have mercy on me, a sinner. I tell you that this man, rather than the other, went home justified before God. For everyone who exalts himself will be humbled, and he who humbles himself will be exalted. So in this first section here, we have this parable. And I love Luke just says, to some who are confident in their own righteousness and look down on everybody else. So that just tells you, okay, this is who this message is for. It's rather, sometimes the scriptures are a little bit cryptic and we have to dig a little deeper. This one's right out here for us all to understand and see easily, okay? Some who are confident in their own righteousness. Now, in all actuality, that should be nobody, But there are people that do. Sometimes we've been involved in church life so long that sometimes we forget where we have come from, don't we? I know that was something that I struggled with as a teenager and young adult and still do now, because church has always been a part of my life, that I never knew what it was like to be, have some kind of crazy testimony where I'm strung out drugs, half dead, laying in the gutter in the street, and, the Lord, church has always been a part of my life. And so if you can identify with that too, sometimes we can get a little high and mighty on ourselves, and we forget that it's not our righteousness that helps us to get where we're at, spiritually speaking. It's all the Lord. So this first thing here, Jesus tells this parable, and there's two kind of words in there. You can see that one. The first one I see is the position here. The words in the text here that stand out to me when I read it this week. When you compare the Pharisee and the tax collector, in verse 11 it says that the Pharisee stood up. So he's standing up, right? He's proud, And then if you go on to verse 14, the tax collector, it said he stood at a distance. So now Jesus said that the so far, and who could go this far, you know, and then all the way at the center was the Holy of Holies. But if you were a Jew, a Jewish man, you could go almost to the full way, but then you had to stop the loads. But if you were a Jewish woman, you could only go halfway. And then if you were a Gentile, well, the men could go a little bit further, but the Gentile woman, sorry ladies, you're all the way in the very back, you know. And so there was this division, there was these dividing walls. And so if you think about that and how the temple was kind of separated, when you see this here, it says that the Pharisees stood up, but then the tax collector stood off at a distance. He didn't even feel worthy to approach as far as he could. So that's kind of where you see that difference right there. So you see the comparison there. And then I also see the word look in the scripture here. I see there's a difference, and there's something we should compare there too. It says, the Pharisee, he looked down on everybody else. You know, he thought he was the greatest thing since sliced bread, and he could do this and that, and quote all the whole book of Leviticus or whatever, you know. And he looked down and said, oh, you can't do that. God, don't worry about that, you know. But then look, in verse 13, it says that the tax collector would not even look up to heaven. There again is that humble attitude. This kind of goes back to what we talked about last week about our position or our posture in prayer. And so for the first thing that will hinder our prayers as believers is our posture here. And it's if we have an attitude of pride. Well, what am I really even praying for? I don't need any prayer. You know, I've got everything to handle myself. You know, that's the old your own righteousness kind of attitude there. And so if you read that again, those words just kind of stood out at me just a little bit here. All right, now, I asked for some volunteers. I need, let's see, Michael and Zachary, if you guys will come on up here, help me out. That's why I come over and stand right here. All right, are you doing the second people over here? All right, you got a minute to win. No, okay, all right, over here. All right, I've got 10 cups over there for each of you. Y'all can stand here. And we'll go, and whoever can stack the cups up in a pyramid first will win. What were you in? I don't know. I'll find something. For the applause people. All right. So, what you do, just do 4, 3, 2, and 1. So, that's how you do it. Right. Pretty self-explanatory, right? You guys think you can do this? Who's going to do it faster? Who do you think? You think you got it? You think Michael's going to?
Exactly.
Man! Well, y'all messed it up. I was going to say, whoever was the one that had most pride, I was going to choose that. Because you both wanted to do each other. You missed it. Alright, well, fun. Alright, let's see here. So, alright, I have some zip ties here. Alright, I'll tell you what, let's see. Since you both were humble, alright, have a seat real quick. I'm going to pee right here. I'm going to zip tie. Okay. Put your feet together. Put your feet together. He's like, what? Your feet too?
Go, Michael, go. your zip ties. Oops.
You should have lost them.
Anyways, thank you guys. The point being, our pride sometimes will get in our way. It will keep us from being effective, okay? We'll come back to that in just a minute here. But our pride can be, very hindering in our prayer life as well. Look at verse 14 there, the last part of the passage here. Jesus said, "I tell you that this man," talking about the tax collector, "rather than the other, went home justified before God." When we come to the Lord, if we have an issue of pride, that will keep us from being justified before the Lord. So that's the first place we need to look at. We need to check and see, how does our attitude come to the Lord in prayer? Do we come just expecting God, I've been a part of Westside Baptist Church for 32 years now, so you better answer my prayer, because, or do we come with a humble attitude? If we come to the Lord in any kind of a prideful way, that will hinder, or the scripture here, for us from being justified before the Lord. So let's remember that. And then verse 14 also, the Bible is full of these great, I call them flip-flops, where the world would say, this is the way to go about doing it, but the Lord says differently. And it says, "For everyone who exalts himself will be humbled, and he who humbles himself will be exalted." So there is one of those flip-flops. And if we want to be humble, the Lord, for the scripture here, he will exalt us in his way, in his time. It's not for our benefit, but he will give us the recognition that he wants us to have. It's not about us. So that's the first prayer prevention there, is pride. Number two, if you turn to Mark chapter 11, and go to verse 20, look at the second one, which is doubt, if you're filling out your outline. Let's see, Mark 11, I'm going to start reading verse 20. "In the morning, as they went along, they saw a fig tree withered from the roots. Peter remembered and said to Jesus, 'Rabbi, look, the fig tree you cursed has withered.' 'Have faith in God,' Jesus answered. 'I tell you the truth, if anyone says to this mountain, go throw yourself into the sea, and does not doubt in his heart, but believes that what he says will happen, it will be done for him. Therefore, I tell you, whatever you ask for in prayer, believe that you have received it, and it will be yours. And when you stand praying, if you hold anything against anyone, forgive him, so that your Father in heaven may also forgive your sins." Now, Jesus says here in verse 22, he says, "Have faith in God." Doubt, when we have doubt in our prayer life, in our prayer times, the Bible talks about this in several places, specifically in James. But when we doubt, when we go before the Lord, that can hinder our prayer life. Verse 23 says, "And he does not doubt in his heart." Now, as I was looking at this week, I'm not a, what kind of a pastor have we hired? I'm not a name it and claim it type person, okay? Lord, give me a brand new jet, or whatever, we're not talking about that. Remember, in the last couple weeks we talked about when we pray in the Father's will, okay? And sometimes it's difficult to discern what God's will is. And sometimes we can get confused. We think, that what we want, that's God's will, because that would be good for me. and sometimes there's confusion there. But according to the scripture here, and this is one thing that I think we need to be careful not to do. We can't come to the scripture and say, and we try to come up with any kind of excuse to kind of make a reason for why that doesn't happen, or that it doesn't say what it actually says in Scripture. The Scripture plainly says here that if anyone does not doubt his heart, God will give him that, okay? And again, we're aligning this with the rest of Scripture, which we're talking about prayer, but we have to go to the Lord in prayer. We have to have confidence. We have to have faith that God we live in a time where we're so bombarded by it. Science, and you know, you read articles in the paper, you know, science says this, science says this, and they try to minimize the religious and the faith side of things, the spiritual side of things, by, you know, explaining all this and all that to us. And what we cannot do as Christians is we cannot allow the modernness of our world that we live in, with all the technology and everything we have, we can't let that affect our prayer life. You know, because God did that for the people in the Old Testament because maybe that's what they thought happened and that's what they wrote down, and we start rationalizing that in our minds about maybe why God answered somebody's prayer in the Bible. And then when it comes to our time and our day, 2020, we say, well, you know, God wouldn't do that because that was, you know, that was in the Bible, but this is now. And God still is the same God today as he's the same God in Moses' day or Abraham's day. He's a miracle-working God. He can do the things then, today as well. Amen. And so we can't, you know, just let our culture invade your mind and convince you that, oh, God's not in the miracle-working business. God still does miracles today. There's a book I want to get next year when it comes out. It's on miracles by Gary Habermas. He's done some extensive research and looking at it, and he's kind of done the legwork looking at all this stuff, and I heard him speak about it. He says, you know, God is still doing a miracle work today, folks, and if we somehow just think, well, you know, it's not like the Bible times, that will affect our mentality and our prayer life as we go to him in prayer. And again, keeping this all in context again, we pray God's will, we pray his will again. We don't pray selfishly or in pride and all these different areas. So that's the second prayer prevention is our doubt. And the third prayer prevention, and I believe this is probably the biggest one of all, number three, is unforgiveness. Let's go, if you have your Bibles, you can turn to Matthew chapter 18. Starting in verse 21. I believe that this prayer prevention is probably the one that hits more people than any of these other things. More than pride, more than doubt sometimes. Let me start reading verse 21. Then Peter came to Jesus and asked, Lord, how many times shall I forgive my brother when he sins against me? Up to seven times? Jesus answered, I tell you, not seven times, but 77 times. Therefore, the kingdom of God, kingdom of heaven, is like a king who went to settle accounts with his servants. As he began the settlement, a man who owed him 10,000 talents was brought to him. Since he was not able to pay, the master ordered that he and his wife, his children, and all he had be sold to repay the debt. And I'm going to skip here, but you've probably heard this parable before. You know, then this servant, he comes back and he pleads with his master. He says, oh, Lord, please forgive me. I'll do this. And the master has pity on him and he forgives him. And he owed 10,000 talents, which is an enormous sum of money. We're talking in the millions and billions, possibly, in our day and age. Okay? So then we get to the end of the parable. So this same servant who has been forgiven much, he finds his other fellow servants who owe him money, and the scripture says that he goes to them and he demands, they pay me back what you owe me. And I love the scripture, it even says that he grabbed them and choked them. You know, wow, what a physical, you know, he paid back to me. Look here, verse 32 in the same chapter 18 says, then the master called the servant in. You wicked servant, he said, I canceled all the debt of yours because you begged me to. Shouldn't you have mercy on your fellow servant just as I have on you? In anger, his master turned him over to the jailer to be tortured until he should pay back all he owed. Listen to verse 35 here. It says, this is how my heavenly Father will treat each of you unless you forgive your brother from your heart. So, that's the key verse right there. This is in Lord's Prayer, when, for a couple weeks ago, we were reading Matthew 6, when Jesus was teaching them how to pray, right there at the end of the, that section, Jesus said, you know, if you go to the altar and you remember that you have something against your brother, go to them, settle that up, and then come back, and then present your offering. So this is in more than one location here that the Lord says that, that we must forgive people. If we want our prayer life to be effective, if we want to have great communication with God, if we want our relationship with the Lord not to be hindered, we have to deal with that issue of unforgiveness. You know, I don't know where you're at this point. Maybe there's somebody in your past that, that you just can't find that strength to forgive a person for something they've done to you, or a family member, or somebody close to you. Forgiveness, you know, it's not for them, but it's more for you. There are benefits when we say, you know, I forgive you. There's power in the ability to forgive people.
Amen.
Things that I have experienced, that you have experienced, when we say those words, I forgive you. You know, and in that power, even though we still might be upset and mad or frustrated, you know, we can still cautiously avoid people. We don't have to go hang around those people that hurt us. Sometimes, you know, it's easier than it's not. But it's our job, it's our duty as believers to forgive people. You might say, "What, Brother John, what does that have to do with?" And I remember thinking this when I was younger, when I heard this passage, it's like, well, if I'm mad at that person, and I don't get forgiveness unless I forgive them, maybe I'll just wait. And I'll wait a year, I'll wait 6 months, and then I'll go give that person forgiveness. And then I'll get forgiveness for my sins. Because I'm not dead yet. Then I can, you know, I'm good. And there's some kind of weird mentality thing that maybe that's what I was thinking when I was younger. You know, I'm not going to forgive that person because they hurt me so bad. And so it's like, you know, I'm still the same. I'm going to go to heaven. And there's that kind of mentality that we have when it comes to not forgiving somebody. But it goes, there's like a step above that. There's one more, I guess, step in it. Okay, yes, if we do not forgive our brothers and sisters in Christ, then Christ won't forgive our sins. But the step after that is simply this. You know, it affects our prayer life. When we go to the Lord, if we haven't forgiven somebody, God doesn't forgive us. And if God hasn't forgiven us, according to some scriptures here, which I'll share a couple with you, it affects not only our forgiveness, but it also affects our ability to intercede for other people, to pray for them. So it's more than just a selfish thing. If I have unforgiveness, things that I haven't settled with the Lord, it affects my prayer life in every different way, not just not being able to get forgiveness from the Lord. It makes my prayers ineffective. Look, I just wrote a couple down in your outline there. I'll read to you two of them. Psalm 66:18 says that if I had cherished sin in my heart, the Lord would not have listened. There's a little bit there. Isaiah 59:2 says, but your iniquities have separated you from your God. So Isaiah is talking to the people of Israel. But your iniquities have separated you from your God. Your sins have hidden his face from you so that he will not hear you. So, and there's a couple more. I'll give you Proverbs 21:13 if you want to write these down. Proverbs 28:9 and James 4:3 are other passages that talk about that when we have unforgiven sin in our lives, it affects our prayer life. I don't want to pry, but I'm asking for you to let the Lord pry in your life this morning as we come to a time here, just an invitation. You may think, well, I don't really have anybody to forgive. I think I've forgiven everybody. You know, let the Lord search you. Is there anything that I have not, you know, cleaned up in my life with somebody in another relationship? Is there anybody that we need to go to? Now, I just want to challenge you this week to do that. Let the Lord continue to work in your life and mine. And as we pray, you may feel like you're okay. But then Tuesday, in your prayer time, Lord, reveal somebody. As you're asking, Lord, is there anybody that I, maybe it's the opposite way. Maybe you need to go to somebody and say, hey, have I offended you? I don't want to do that. And you work that relationship right with the Lord. Because that is one thing, or the scripture here, that will keep us from inheriting and having a great, effective prayer life. And in just a few minutes, we're going to come and close. I just want to remind you of the table here. If you want to look for a prayer partner, you're welcome to come up and put a post-it up here. Put who you're praying for, as we talked about last week. Praying for a spouse, prayer partner, praying for a family member, praying for a ministry like Tim Cummings and Whirlwind Missions. These are things that you're committing to pray for. That's what the post-it is. Today, I want to give you an opportunity to come here and get a zip tie. I got different colors, got black and all that. But I want you to take one, if you will, as a reminder that some things will hinder our prayer life. Sometimes things get in the way. And you can take one of those. I put one in my backpack here, so I have it with me all the time. Students, if you see that, you got it in your backpack. It's kind of lighter. I'm not suggesting you put it on your wrist. That's not it. But put it somewhere, maybe if you see it. Maybe you put it in your car. Maybe you put that, you remind yourself that, hey, I don't want anything hindering my relationship with the Lord. I'm going to try to do my best to keep a clean heart and keep my relationship with other people in a peaceful, forgiving state. So you're welcome to come and take one of the zip ties this morning if you want to. Put it somewhere that you'll see it, wherever it works for you. Use it, your Bible as a bookmark, that's fine. Whatever. Get creative with it. But this morning, as we close, I want to tell you that the very best prayer you can pray is to pray and ask Christ in your life. And I think, let's see, Ashley, I think one of the three circles that are up there, I keep putting them there, I keep forgetting to talk about it. This is called the three circles. It's just kind of a way to explain the gospel here. But you see, God's design up there in the first circle there. He created us to have a relationship with Him, to live with Him. It's Adam and Eve in the garden. But then you see the arrow there that goes and it says sin. Sin keeps us from, and it makes us broken. And it keeps us from having that relationship with Him. The sin that Adam and Eve committed, they disobeyed God. And from that point, Scripture says that sin entered the world. That, one of the students asked this Wednesday, he said, Brother John, if Adam and Eve didn't sin, do you think somebody else would have? I was like, yes. And I think, I don't know who it was, Derek or somebody, gave a great answer. They said, the Bible says that for all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. So, if it not Adam and Eve, it would have been the next person. We're all sinners. But sin keeps us from having a relationship with God. So what do we do with that? The next circle up there says that we need to repent and believe. We need to repent of our sin. Repent trying to live for ourselves and live our own ways to live without Christ. And we need to believe that Jesus died for us on the cross, that His death paid for our sins. And then, only after that, then we can recover and pursue God's design for our life. So it's a continual thing. Once we have a relationship with Christ, we can fully live our best life for Him, what He designed for us to live, to serve Him, to worship Him, all the different things that truth can do. So this morning, as we close, I just want to offer the sinner's prayer. If you would like to ask Christ to come in your life, maybe you've heard for a couple weeks now, you keep talking about having a relationship with Jesus, praying this prayer. According to Romans 10:13, it says that whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved.
Amen.
That's what the scripture teaches. So this morning, I just ask you to close your eyes, bow your heads, and if you would like to ask Jesus Christ to come into your life, you can pray a prayer. You can ask Him to, not exactly word for word. I know that I'm a sinner. I know that you love me. I know that you died on the cross for me. Today, Lord, I want you to come into my life. Forgive me of my sin. Help me put my faith and trust in you. Today, Lord, I make you Lord of my life. Thank you for saving me. In Jesus' name. If you pray that prayer today, I'd love to just come down and shake your hand and pray for you and kind of help you in your next step as a new believer and how you can fully live out God's purpose for your life. The altar's open today. If you just want to come and pray, maybe the Lord has something on your heart you just want to take before Him, you can pray in your hand, but I tell you, when you step out, when you're a little bold, it helps you to make a commitment to it. So I want to encourage you to do that. You're going to come down, put a post-it note about somebody you're praying for, or you're looking for a prayer partner, or if you want to come get a zip tie to help remember things that will hinder our prayer life. The altar's open for you today.
Bring to your attention, there is an offering plate at the back of the church. Bring your tithes and offerings, place them in that plate. You'll be blessed for that. Those of you who are watching online, there's several opportunities given to send your tithes and offering in through the internet or through the mail. Don't rob yourself. Father, we ask you today, bless this offering.
Amen.
Both tithe and gifts.
Amen.
Both money that has bless our time, bless our energy, that we might do everything that we do in a way that brings glory and honor to the name Jesus. Let this money be used to increase your kingdom, to glorify your name. Bless it in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Before you go for the afternoon, just wanted to give you a couple announcements. Bob's got an announcement too. Tonight we'll be looking at Genesis 19, Sodom and Gomorrah, at 6 o'clock. So if you can make it tonight, and we'll have a good discussion on that. Bob.
Good job.
And half on the water. For sure, early to start on the 9th of September. This is Wednesday after Labor Day. I would ask if you would come out this Wednesday night at 6 o'clock, right, to kind of meet together and go over some things. So if you're able to, those of you who have agreed to or said you could help some or some Wednesday nights, I'd love to kind of get with you if you can come out on Wednesday night at 6, this Wednesday night. And we'll kind of make some plans there. So if you agree to, if you're able to come to Wednesday night, you're not understand, or if anybody else is interested, we'll take as many couples as we can and get up long ago. So if you're able to come out this Wednesday night at 6 o'clock, we'll meet back here. And we'll see you then. Thanks, y'all.
Have a great day, Lord. We'll see you this evening or this week.
Good job, bro. I know what you're preaching on next Sunday.